This morning we begin the class, Answering the New Atheism. I said I taught the class maybe 3 years ago. There are going to be some new things. And of course, I was upstairs then. Now, atheism, of course, it has a long history. The psalmist declares in Psalm 14:1, Psalm 53:1, that the fool says in his heart, there is no God. Now, some ancient Greek and Roman philosophers, they were essentially atheists, because they thought that any deities that existed were uninterested in and thus irrelevant to human existence. For example, the Greek philosopher Epicurus and the Roman philosopher Lucretius. They thought that matter was all that there is, and when you die, you just die. So atheism certainly isn't anything new. Now, you may be familiar with the names of some more recent atheist philosophers. The 17th century brought us Baruch Spinoza and Thomas Hobbes. The 18th century brought us Voltaire. The 19th century brought us Ludwig Feuerbach, Friedrich Nietzsche, and Karl Marx. And the 20th century brought us Jean-Paul Sartre, Albert Camus, Bertrand Russell, J.L. Mackey, Anthony Flew. And representatives of atheist philosophy have continued into the 21st century. So what's meant by the term new atheism? I mean, if atheism goes back into antiquity, what is meant by the term new atheism? Well, that term was coined by Gary Wolfe in a 2006 article in Wired magazine. It refers to a new breed of atheists that arose in the aftermath of the Muslim attacks on America on September 11, 2001. We're going to work? Oh, I got to turn it on. Oh. Sam Harris, a neuroscientist, he began writing his book titled The End of Faith, Religion, Terror, and the Future of Reason. He began writing that book the day after September 12, 2001. His book was published in August of 2004, and it spent 33 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. In 2006, the British zoologist, Richard Dawkins, who at the time, Dawkins was the Charles Simeoni Professor for the Public Understanding of Science at Oxford University, so he's not an unknown person. But in 2006, he published a similarly successful book titled The God Delusion. That book received rave reviews in the secular press, and Kirkus Reviews chose that book as the best book of the year for 2006. That same year, 2006, Harris published another book titled Letter to a Christian Nation. And the philosopher Daniel Dennett, he published his book, Breaking the Spell, Religion as a Natural Phenomenon. These were also New York Times bestsellers. In 2007, the late journalist Christopher Hitchens, who died in December of 2011, but in 2007 he published God is Not Great, How Religion Poisons Everything. Library Journal described Hitchens' book as a, quote, provocative, challenging, and passionate work. And it too was a marketing success. Now these four individuals, Harris, Dawkins, Hitchens, and Dennett, they have been called the four horsemen of the new atheism. And since Dennett's a bit more measured in his attacks, three of those four, Harris, Dawkins, and Hitchens, they've been called the unholy trinity of the new atheism. And of these three, Wolfe, in that 2006 Wired article, he crowned Dawkins the leading light of the new atheism movement. Now, Ronald Aronson, he remarked in The Nation magazine in June of 2007, he said, the most remarkable fact is not that there is not their books themselves, blunt, no-holds-barred attacks on religion in different registers, but they have succeeded in reaching mainstream readers and in becoming bestsellers. They have pumped this stuff into the society, into the culture, by the millions. Now, others who are often associated with the new atheism. They include the physicist Victor Stenger, the University of Chicago biologist Jerry Coyne, and the ASU physicist Lawrence Krauss. In 2008, Stenger published a book titled God, the Failed Hypothesis, How Science Shows That God Does Not Exist, which he followed in 2009 with the New Atheism, taking a stand for science and reason, and in 2012 with God and the Folly of Faith, the incompatibility of science and religion. In 2009, Jerry Coyne published the book Why Evolution is True, and in 2012, Krauss published A Universe from Nothing. Now, further down the new atheism ladder, you get bloggers like a biologist P.Z. Myers and the Hollywood celebrity Bill Maher, and you get some other people like that. Now, these atheists, you know, you say, well, what's new about it? Why the new atheism? These atheists, they're a new breed, not because of their arguments or their intellectual sophistication. What's new about them is their open hostility to religion in general and Christianity in particular, though some of them have more recently begun to at least talk about Islam. But as you'll see, they really have a burr under their saddle about Christianity. Now, they're not content to argue against the truth of religious claims. That's gone on for a long time. They're not content to do that, to argue against the truth of religious claims. Rather, they insist that religion is so irrational and harmful to society that it's unworthy of respect and toleration. See, it's unworthy of respect and toleration. It's something that needs to be ridiculed and eliminated. Now, lest you think I exaggerate, here's Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins, the leading light, in 1997, he wrote in Humanist magazine, "It is fashionable to wax apocalyptic about the threat to humanity posed by the AIDS virus, mad cow disease, and many others, but I think a case can be made that faith is one of the world's great evils, comparable to the smallpox virus, but harder to eradicate." In the fall 2002 issue of Free Inquiry, Dawkins said, "The mental abuse constituted by an unsubstantiated threat of violence and terrible pain, if sincerely believed by the child, could easily be more damaging than the physical actuality of sexual abuse. An extreme threat of violence and pain is precisely what the doctrine of hell is, and there's no doubt at all that many children sincerely believe it." So do you see, he's saying this is worse than sexual abuse, what you're doing there. Now, in a program, television program that aired in 2006 in the United Kingdom titled Root of All Evil, Dawkins said, "When it comes to children, I think of religion as a dangerous virus. It's a virus which is transmitted partly through teachers and clergy, but also down the generations from parent to child to grandchild. Children are especially vulnerable to infection by the virus of religion." So here you see Dawkins' attitude and spirit showing up. In his 2006 book, The God Delusion, Dawkins wrote, "When one person suffers from a delusion, it's called insanity. When many people suffer from a delusion, it's called religion." Now, toward the end of that book, he wrote, now here you see this, look at what's driving this guy. "I have described the atonement, the central doctrine of Christianity." Now you want to be blasphemous. He says, "I've described the atonement, the central doctrine of Christianity, as vicious, sadomasochistic, and repellent. We should also dismiss it as barking mad, but for its ubiquitous familiarity, which has dulled our objectivity." Now that's somebody, you see, who's got an axe to grind against something. Sam Harris declared in his 2004 book, he said, "It is imperative that we begin speaking plainly about the absurdity of most of our religious beliefs." Gary Wolfe, in that 2006 Wired article, he describes Harris as touting the notion that, quote, unless we renounce faith. Unless we renounce faith, religious violence will soon bring civilization to an end. And in an interview that was published in the Sun magazine in September of 2006, Harris said, "If I could wave a magic wand and get rid of either rape or religion, one or the other, I would not hesitate to get rid of religion." Okay? These are the warm, fuzzy people, you see, who are out there. Now, in his 2007 book, The Portable Atheist, Christopher Hitchens said, "It is time to, quote, withdraw our, quote, respect." He puts respect in scare quotes because he means I never respected them. But it's time to withdraw our respect from such fantastic claims as a, quote, creator who only chooses to reveal himself to semi-stupefied peasants in desert regions. Now, the British journalist Brian Appleyard, he wrote in the cover story to the February 27, 2012 issue of the British magazine New Statesman. He said, "To hardline atheists, it is now unreasonable and dramatically peculiar to argue that religion is not altogether evil." They find that mind-blowing. You can't, how can you even think that? It is altogether evil. And you're crazy to think otherwise. He says, "How did such intolerance become acceptable to rational minds?" March 1st, 2014, 1 year from today, Victor Stenger wrote in the online journal Science, Religion, and Culture, he says, "New atheism recognizes religion for what it is, a set of unfounded superstitions that have been the greatest hindrance to human progress that ever existed on this planet." Just a couple months ago, Bill Maher, he said on the Jimmy Kimmel Show, "There are no great religions. They're all stupid and dangerous, and we should insult them." They're all stupid and dangerous, and we should insult them. Now, here's what Richard Osling, he's a religion writer for the Associated Press. Here's what Osling put on his blog in October of 2013 about the question, well, what is new about the new atheism? Osling says, "What's new about new atheism? No, not substantive arguments for disbelief, which are as perennial as the case for God, rather a tactical lurch toward emotion-laden partisanship and take-no-prisoners rhetoric that might make a fundamentalist blush." And that's what you're seeing. It's not the intellectual sophistication. It is not the argument. What is new is they've come out as rabid dogs trying to destroy religion. They see it as the great evil that must absolutely be eradicated. And these new atheists, you see, they're evangelistic. They are aggressively seeking to turn people from religious faith to convert them to atheism. Here's what Wolf wrote in that 2006 Wired article. "The atheist movement, by Dawkins' lights, has no choice but to aggressively spread the good news. Evangelism is a moral imperative. Dawkins does not merely disagree with religious myths. He disagrees with tolerating them, with cooperating in their colonization of the brains of innocent tykes. How much do we regard children as being the property of their parents?" Dawkins asks. "It's one thing to say people should be free to believe whatever they like, but should they be free to impose their beliefs on their children? Is there something to be said for society, read government, stepping in? What about bringing up children to believe manifest falsehoods?" See, so you already see in the wind, don't you? The government should come and save these children from something that is the equivalent of sexual abuse. This is Dawkins, the leading light of the new atheist movement. You see, as Dawkins has made, he's made his goal quite clear. He made it clear in his 2006 book, The God Delusion. Dawkins wrote there, "If this book works as intended, religious leaders who open it will be atheists when they put it down." And then Dawkins interviewed Christopher Hitchens. Hitchens died in December of 2011. The interview, Dawkins' interview of Hitchens, was published in December of 2011. Now listen to what Dawkins says to Hitchens, what he asks Hitchens. Do you ever worry that if we win, and so to speak, destroy Christianity, the vacuum would be filled by Islam? Does that ever trouble you? If we achieve our goal, if we are victorious, well, what do you mean by that, Richard? And destroy Christianity? Do you ever worry? So, I mean, is it not clear what's thereafter? What their goal is? They tell us. In the 2006 Wired article, Harris prophesied, he says, well, at some point, there's going to be enough pressure that it's just going to be too embarrassing to believe in God. You're going to be, you know, see the ideas, and they're working hard for that. You know, they want you going, oh, I'm sorry, I'm just a moron. I'm not nearly as smart as you. Can you please forgive me? And no, I don't want to think, no, I'm just embarrassed. That's what they want. They want you to say that I cannot intellectually be a believer. That's complete nonsense. But they're trying to generate that, see, so people will be embarrassed. That's what he says. Too embarrassed to believe in God. Jerry Coyne wrote a paper in the journal Evolution, April 2012. Coyne says, after having taught evolution for years, meaning Coyne and his Darwinist colleagues, we finally recognize where our real opposition lies. Creationism is simply one of the many symptoms of religion. It follows that naturalistic evolution won't attract a majority of Americans until our nation becomes less religious. That, of course, is contrary to accommodationism, the idea that Darwinism and Christianity should peacefully coexist, which takes religion as a given. But one suspects that we could best promote evolution by concentrating on bringing Catholics and mainline Protestants into the no-religion category. See, what I'm telling you, they're evangelistic. This isn't like, I say, oh, you go ahead, you know, you have that faith, I respect that. I think that's rational. I think that's reasonable. I disagree with it. But you go ahead and you raise your... No. It's the worst thing in the world. It's destroying society, and we have to get rid of it. We're going to ridicule it. We're going to make it too embarrassing to believe. And we're going to make people so they can't hold their head up, and they think that there's no rational basis for believing in God and for having faith. This exchange between Stephen Sacker and Daniel Dennett, this took place in an interview that aired on the BBC News in April of 2013. Sacker, Richard Dawkins talks of religion in a way to think of it almost like a virus. Dennett, that's why I use that example. There are lots of symbiotes, lots of parasites and viruses and bacteria that thrive on us and other species. Some of them are very useful to us. Some are just along for the ride. They don't hurt. And a few of them, a small minority, are really hurtful. They're bad for us. And in that sense, in the intellectual sense, in the idea sense, religion is bad for us, and therefore we need a cure. Is that what you're saying? A cure. Yes, indeed. I think a lot of people are really afflicted by their religion, and I would love to see them cured. This is where we are. This is what they're saying. 2009, Dawkins launched an atheist summer camp. An atheist summer camp in England that's designed to teach children rationalism and skepticism. And these summer camps have gone all over the United States. These kids' camps, we're going to do what? We're going to teach them how to be little growing atheists. And you see them now, Arizona, California, Colorado, Connecticut. I could go on and on. You see these camps in Ontario and Ireland and Norway. They're not just sitting here saying, well, you know, let's live and let live. You know, religion's been around a long time. A lot of great minds have been religious. Of course, they think they were really, you know, their ideas. No, anybody who thought that way is a moron. And can't think that way now because science has come to the rescue and shown us all. We're all now enlightened and we realize that there's no rational basis for believing in God. This is their push and what they're after. 2011, Dawkins published a children's book titled The Magic of Reality, How We Know What's Really True. And Neville Hawcock said of that book in London's Financial Times, he said, give me the child, the Jesuit maxim is supposed to have run, and I will give you the man. But not if Richard Dawkins gets there first. The arch-atheist's new book, The Magic of Reality, is designed to inoculate tender minds once and for all against the supernatural and its apologists. So here he's got a children's book, you see. And what do you mean? He said, no, here, I want you to feed this to your children. Why? I want to inoculate them against faith so that they will be have the sense that faith is stupid and you can't rationally believe it. You see, I want to get them young. See, so they're already, so when they hear about God, that they've been predisposed, oh, no, I know what's really smart thinking, you see. And so that's something that you see going on. The John Simon Guggenheim Memorial Foundation commissioned Lawrence Pringle, who's a very well-known writer of children's books. They commissioned him to write a book about evolution for children under the guidance of the rabid atheist Jerry Coyne. And that book, Billions of Years, Amazing Changes, The Story of Evolution, that was published in the fall of 2011. And a number of other atheist books for children have been published since then. You see, so this market is hot and growing. Now, atheist groups, they're engaged in a media blitz that includes billboards declaring, you don't need God to hope, to care, to love, to live. I'd put a footnote, only to do it rationally, but we'll get to that. Okay, that's one of their billboards. There's probably no God. Now stop worrying and enjoy life. One of their billboards, we're all atheists about most gods. Some of us just go one God further. That sounds really clever, doesn't it? That's one God too many. Do you see? That's like saying, well, we're all atheists about advanced life on other planets. Some of us just go one planet further in denying that there's advanced life on Earth. Well, you see, that would be a mistake then to go that one further, wouldn't it? But it sounds cute. And see, if you don't think about these things, this is what they're after. This kind of stuff where I just say, here, let me just mess with you a little bit here and get, oh, wow, that's true. They're just going one further. Well, that's a big one. You see, they're going from, you know, to atheism, and that's a big jump. Now, it's no coincidence that disrespect of and hostility toward religion, that they are increasing in our culture. For example, in April 2012, the homosexual activist Dan Savage, who has given presentations in President Obama's White House, well, he launched an obscenity-laced tirade against the Bible, speaking to 3,000 high school students who were attending a journalism conference. He's got a group of high school kids there, and he goes off on the Bible. You see, and that would have never happened just a few years ago. And don't think that government is immune. Nothing happens in a vacuum. And as the culture's perception of the respectability of religious conviction, as that is drained away, the government acts in accordance with that. More and more we see the faith concerns of people in the realm of public policy being steamrolled. Christian individuals and groups are being required by the government either to cease operating or to violate their consciences regarding things like abortion and homosexual conduct. According to the Pew Research Institute's January 2014 report, using a variety of measures, they have like 20 different measures they use to come up with this, but the U.S. government restrictions on religion rose from 1.6 in 2007. This is a 1 to 10 scale that they evaluate based on all these factors, and then they put them on a 1 to 10 scale. It rose from a 1.6 in 2007 to 3.7 in December of 2012. Now, we've gone from a low-level restriction group, which is what we were at 1.6. You know, they break them up, low-level, moderate, high, super high. We've gone from the low-level, now we're in the moderate level of government restrictions on religion, and we're only 0.8 of a point away from the high level. And so nothing happens in a vacuum. According to the 2013 edition of the Liberty Institute survey of hostility to religion in America, There are almost 1,200 incidents of legal actions in America that were hostile to religion, approximately double the number from the prior year, to almost 1,200. So it's not surprising that the subject of the Beckett Fund's 2012 National Religious Freedom Conference was the rising threats to religious freedom. They saw what's happening. In March 2014, the Pope and Vatican officials expressed to President Obama their concern over threats to religious freedom in the United States a year ago. You got the Pope and Vatican officials going to the President of the United States and saying, you know, this used to be the home of the brave, the free. What's going on? They expressed their concerns to him. And the things have gotten so difficult and bad in the U.S. military that a coalition has been formed. The Restoring Military Religious Freedom Coalition to defend the religious freedoms of members of the armed forces. Because more and more, they're atheizing, if I can use that word, the armed forces, and going after people who dare to speak their faith. Now, in this class, what I'm going to do in this class, this is all introduction, right? In this class, I'm going to explore certain arguments that are put forth by these new atheists, especially as they relate to Christianity. Their arguments, you see, when you hear them, they may sound disturbing, and that's part of why I want you to hear them. Because that's part of you being aware, and you see, sometimes we send people out into the world, we send young people out, we never talk about stuff like this. And we just send them out there, and then they got these guys, Mr. PhD, going, well, you know, oh, well, no, nobody thinks that. I'm your teacher, and that's moronic, and you need to listen to me. And, wow. Or they throw out some of these things that have some initial traction that they haven't thought about. Wow, I didn't know that. And these teachers think it's their job. I don't care if they're at a public university being supported by taxpayers. They still think it's their job to take your kids and train them morally. And say, listen, you know, you leave the moral instruction to me, okay? You just teach them. God gave them to me. You leave the moral instruction to me. But that's not what they're doing. That's not what they're doing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through these arguments and help you see that they are not what they seem to be at first blush. I'm going to engage them, and you will see that whatever they sound like when you first hear them, they're really much bluster and they're little substance. And to show you that I'm not that, you know, that this just isn't preacher talk. I'm not alone in that assessment. You say, well, look, you know, who are you and what do you know? Okay, these guys writing books. But to show you that I'm not alone in that assessment, let me give you some quotes from some respected thinkers. Okay, Alvin Plantinga, he's a world-class Christian philosopher. He retired from the University of Notre Dame in 2010. And he's recognized as one of the most important and influential philosophers of the 20th century and the early 21st centuries. After noting in his review, he reviewed Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, and after noting in his review that, quote, the proportion of insult, ridicule, mockery, spleen, and vitriol is astounding, end quote. You see, he's used to playing with academics who, you know, they want to talk ideas, not a mud fight. But as he looks at Dawkins' thing and he says, this is what this is. But after saying that, he says, now despite the fact, this is Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, that was considered wonderful and Kirkus reviews, you know, and all this stuff, oh, this is the best book ever. And all right, now despite the fact that this book is mainly philosophy, Dawkins is not a philosopher, he's a biologist. Even taking this into account, however much of the philosophy he purveys is at best jejune. It is lacks meat. It's not interesting. It's trivial. He says, you might say that some of his forays into philosophy are at best sophomoric, but that would be unfair to sophomores. The fact is, grade inflation aside, many of his arguments would receive a failing grade in a sophomore philosophy class. This, combined with the arrogant, smarter than thou being believers in God, tone of the book can be annoying. He says, the God delusion is full of bluster and bombast, But it really doesn't give even the slightest reason for thinking belief in God is mistaken, let alone a delusion. Now, of course, if you're somebody like Dawkins, you don't care. But when you've got somebody who is a thinker like Plantinga saying this about what you've written, you ought to at least stop and say, is there anything to be said for that? I mean, this guy is a well-known philosopher. See, they ought to stop and give that some thought. David Bentley Hart, who's a noted theologian and philosopher, he writes in his 2009 book that was published by Yale University Press. It is titled Atheist Delusions, The Christian Revolution and Its Fashionable Enemies. Hart says, the God delusion is an energetic attack on all religious belief. An energetic attack on all religious belief has just been released by Richard Dawkins, the zoologist and tireless tractarian, who, despite his embarrassing incapacity for philosophical reasoning, never fails to entrance his eager readers with his rhetorical recklessness. The journalist Christopher Hitchens, whose talent for intellectual caricature somewhat exceeds his mastery of consecutive logic, has issued God Is Not Great, a book that raises the wild non sequitur almost to the level of a dialectical method. Now, I don't know, you know, these guys are not impressed. You see, they're not impressed with what is being pushed in the public as deep thinking. That's masterful. That's really deep. Whoa. You see, people look at it and they go, no, this is really like, you know, this is not really any big deal. You see, in fact, this looks like it's flawed deeply. You see, it looks like it's flawed deeply. Well, even fellow atheists are put off by Dawkins' effort. Okay, so it's not simply like Plantinga, who's a Christian philosopher, David Bentley Hart, but you have atheist philosophers who are put off by it. Michael Ruse is an atheist philosopher at Florida State University. He says, let me say, well, first, Ruse had said that before, Michael Ruse wrote that, he said that Dawkins' book makes me embarrassed to be an atheist. Makes me embarrassed to be an atheist. But then he wrote in this article in August of 2009, he said, let me say that I believe the new atheists do the side of science a grave disservice. I will defend to the death the right of them to say what they do, but I think first that these people do a disservice to scholarship. Their treatment of the religious viewpoint is pathetic to the point of non-being. Richard Dawkins in The God Delusion would fail any introductory philosophy or religion course. Proudly, he criticizes that whereof he knows nothing. This guy's an atheist. Okay, he's an atheist. Now you see H. Allen Orr, who's an atheist geneticist, when he reviewed Dawkins' book in the New York Book Review, Review of Books, he says, the God delusion seems to me badly flawed. Though I once labeled Dawkins a professional atheist, I'm forced after reading his new book to conclude he's actually more an amateur. The most disappointing feature of the God delusion is Dawkins' failure to engage religious thought in any serious way. This is obviously an odd thing to say about a book-length investigation of God. But see, they have caricatures. They don't go out and they don't find and say, well, what is the strongest argument? What if they just have this idea that religion is stupid. You see, it's just stupid. And so they don't feel the need to go out and actually engage it intellectually. They just want to smear it, because what they want to do is they want to get people who are leaning that way and looking for justification to come out from under God to say, you see, that's right. Dawkins, these people say that there's no God. Whew, I didn't want to be under him anyway. You see? So they just want to feed this stuff. Just feed this stuff to people, and they've been very successful at it. Now, the charge, a major theme, and this is why I'm going to spend a good deal of time, weeks on this, but a major theme of the new atheist is that Christianity, like all religions, promotes beliefs. This is what's so bad about Christianity. This is what's so bad about religion. Is that they promote beliefs that are irrational. irrational in the sense there is absolutely no evidence for those beliefs. There is no reason whatsoever to believe that the claims of Christianity are true. Christianity is accused of getting people to believe fantasies, just complete hallucinations, nonsense. Getting people to believe that, see, things that they have absolutely no reason to believe are true. It's like crazy. Like some guy thinks he's a duck or something. All right, let me back that up and show you why I say that. Sam Harris, we have names for people who have many beliefs for which there's no rational justification. When their beliefs are extremely common, we call them religious. Otherwise, they're likely to be called mad, psychotic, or delusional. To be ruled by ideas for which you have no evidence is generally a sign that something is seriously wrong with your mind. Now, in his book, The End of Faith, that book that was published in 2004, he said, religion's the one area in life in which we've convinced ourselves that, quote, our beliefs about the world can float entirely free of reason and evidence. Float entirely free of reason and evidence. This quote, he writes, this is from, that was on page 17, this is from page 72 of that book. He then wrote in 2008, he said, faith is generally nothing more than the permission religious people give one another to believe things without evidence. That was in his book, Letter to a Christian Nation. In his 1976 book, The Selfish Gene, Dawkins, he defined faith as, quote, blind trust in the absence of evidence, even in the teeth of evidence, end quote. He said in 1989, whereas scientific belief is based upon publicly checkable evidence, religious faith not only lacks evidence, its independence from evidence is its joy. It shouted from the rooftops. In 1997, Dawkins wrote in Humanist magazine, faith being belief that isn't based on evidence is the principal vice of any religion. And in 2006, in The God Delusion, he defined faith as a persistent, he defined it as a, quote, persistent belief held in the face of strong contradictory evidence. March 2014, Victor Stenger, the physicist Victor Stenger, in an article, the article I previously mentioned, he says here that the new atheists question whether faith, which is belief despite the absence or evidence or even in the presence of contrary evidence, has any moral or intellectual authority. This is what they're saying. This is the idea. Christian faith, religious belief, is just nuts. You can't be a rational, intellectual thinker. You say, well, what do you think about all these people through millennia? Some of the greatest minds this planet has ever seen. Well, they just didn't have modern science to show them they were morons. Reminds me of that thing in The Princess Bride. You remember that? That little dude sitting there going, Aristotle, Socrates, morons. You see, but this is what we have here. Now the fact of the matter is that Christian beliefs do not float entirely free of reason and evidence. They do not. That's the first bell, right? Mm-hmm. Here's what the philosopher Paul Chamberlain, he says in his 2011 book, Why People Don't Believe God. Chamberlain says, the most important thing we can say to the assertion that Christian truth claims, quote, float entirely free of reason and evidence, that's Harris's line, is that it's simply false. In fact, it is so flagrantly false that one wonders what the critics are reading or smoking or researching when they make it such an assertion. As many of them know, Christian philosophers and theologians such as St. Thomas Aquinas, Blaise Pascal, C.S. Lewis, Richard Swinburne, philosopher at Oxford, Alvin Plantinga, William Lane Craig, James P. Moreland, a host of others throughout the history of Christianity have piled up thousands of pages of evidence for the truth claims Christianity presents to the world. It's not like it's a secret. You know, you don't have to be on some kind of insider with a secret handshake to get this information. It's all out there. They apparently overlook it. The New Testament itself points to the importance of providing evidence for beliefs. Acts chapter 1 verse 3 says, Jesus presented himself alive by what? By many proofs. He presented himself alive by many proofs. Luke tells Theophilus in Luke chapter 1 verses 3 and 4 that he was providing a researched, orderly account to Theophilus that he might know the certainty of the things that he'd been told. Why does he care about that? Why don't you just tell him, believe? You don't have to know anything, think anything, know any facts, have any reason. Just believe. Just pick something crazy. Just do that. 1 Peter 3:15, Peter tells his readers to always be ready to give a reason for the hope they have. And he tells them in 2 Peter 1:16 that he and others, what? They did not follow cleverly devised myths when they made known to them the power and coming of the Lord Jesus, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He says, we're not morons. We're not dupes. We're not just people falling into something. There's reason for this. We saw him. And we testified to it. You see, there's reason for this. 1 Corinthians 15, 3-7, Paul identifies people to whom Christ appeared after his resurrection, many of whom he were still alive, and therefore they could be asked about it. That's significant. He says, he writes a letter and says, they saw him and they're still alive. Go ask them. So he says that. And then he declares in 1 Corinthians 15, 17-19 that if Christ did not in fact rise from the dead, if it's a myth, if it's a lie, if they've been duped, if that's not objectively true, then Christianity, Paul says, is a sham and it should be rejected. It's not a thing, well, you know, I want to believe he rose from the dead. He really didn't, but I want to believe it. It gives me warm feelings. Paul says if he didn't rise, it's bogus. Okay? Reason. They work together. Contrary to the new atheist claims, faith and evidence, they're not mutually exclusive. It is not either faith or evidence. Faith is not some unjustified, groundless fantasy like Harris's illustration. The illustration he uses is that Nicole Kidman is in love with him despite his never having met her. That's what he thinks faith is. Nicole, I've never met her, don't have any contact with her at all, but I'm convinced she loves me. That's faith. That's not faith. That is a fantasy. But the idea that he thinks you can correlate that to biblical faith, it just says, where is this guy growing up? What little world and bubble is he living in? That he's not engaging these things on a broader level. Evidence can help lead us to faith in God and can help lead us to trust in his word. Christianity is not opposed to reason and evidence. They are allies in the Christian faith, and they always have been allies in the Christian faith. Now, what we're going to do next week, I heard that bell. Next week, we're going to begin looking, well, what kind of reasonable, rational way could a theist have? I mean, I think he's just fantasizing this stuff like Nicole Kidman. Can he actually have reasons for thinking? Well, don't give me the Bible, okay? I happen to believe the Bible, okay? I believe the Bible. But we'll talk, we'll set it aside for this, okay? And we'll say, can you really just reason and think? Are there reasons, or is it all just a harebrained fantasy like Nicole Kidman's in love with me? There are reasons, and we're going to walk through them. And my hope is that when you get through, you'll be going, now I know why those guys said those things about the new atheist writings. Okay? Thanks for coming.